Hi, my name is Stuart Sumida, and I'm a paleontologist who helps to build characters like the dinosaurs you've seen in Jurassic World, animated characters from cartoons, creatures that you see like dragons in visual effects films, all those kinds of things, all because I'm a scientist. When we look at skeletons of dinosaurs in the museum, well, we see bones. Of course, if you see a dinosaur or something like a dinosaur, say a mosasaur in the water or a pterosaur in the air in a film, how do we come up with that? Right? Well, part of the answer is that we turn to scientists who have a strong idea of how these animals were built and how they may have worked. But then those people have to work together with what we call visual effects artists. They're a fancy word for computer scientists who have artistic abilities to help bring these things to life. And this is one of the great things about the science of paleontology. Paleontologists work to help you understand past life. Well, one of the things that happens with visual effects artists who make movies like Jurassic World or How to Train Your Dragon or anything like that is that what they're doing is they're taking data, the information of how things are built, and they're creating those same things on screen the same way we're trying to teach you about how they looked in their past lives. It takes a lot of collaborative effort, but it is sometimes surprising to people just how much science goes into making art. Eh? If you think of an animated film, say something like Zootopia, or that was called Zootropolis in other continents, that looks like a cartoon. If you think about a dinosaur on screen in Jurassic World, you know the dinosaurs don't exist, so they had to be made somehow. They had to be built in a computer so that you can then see them on screen. So someone had to come up with a way to visualize those things for you. The first thing you have to do is figure out how it's shaped. That's done by a concept artist. The concept artist works with the scientist to come up with what we think is a reasonable way that those animals might have looked and shaped in a way that so that they could move in a reasonable fashion as well. That's then handed off to someone called a rigger, and a rigger inserts a computer skeleton, like the marionette of a puppet, into this modeled character with the help of, again, a scientist, a paleontologist like myself, or some of the other people who worked on these films, to help to understand where the joints were. So maybe if the arm's going to swing in a certain way, we have to know where that pivot point goes inside of the modeled character. That then gets handed off to an animator. An animator is someone who has to understand the movement and make these characters act on screen. And they're all actors. Animators are actors behind the camera. Okay? And then what happens is they move them through the scene bit by bit by bit to create a way for these things to move. Well, once again, you have to work with the scientist who has a reasonable idea of how they might have moved. You can make them move any way you want in the computer, but for the audience to suspend its disbelief or accept the way it moves, and accept the story that they're being told, they have to move in what seems like a realistic fashion. So once again, we turn to the scientists as collaborators with the artists. Now, scientists who help on these kinds of films know we're not making documentaries. There aren't really dinosaurs alive today, like in Jurassic World. But if there were, how would they move? That's where we come in. And one of the great things is if you do this kind of work, where you help artists, what you're doing is you're creating a collaborative community where artists and scientists work together. One of the phrases we hear these days is science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, STEM. But the thing is that STEM, with all due respect, can be sort of boring. How do you make it exciting? You turn it to STEAM. You put in art. Okay? And when you do that, visually, it's exciting. I know the T-Rex didn't live in the Jurassic of Jurassic Park or Jurassic World, but if you can build a T-Rex that looks like it moves correctly, everybody's excited, and it brings people in. It brings them into your story, and I can tell you, as a practicing scientist who works at a university and teaches standard courses like human and animal anatomy, that an entire generation of scientists who are interested in paleontology were inspired by these films. They knew they weren't documentaries, but they were so excited that they went into the field. And you know what? Someone's gonna look at these films and be inspired, not necessarily to be a paleontologist, but to look to science and see what science can do for society and for the world. So one of the things I love about dinosaurs as in being a paleontologist is, in fact, dinosaurs have played a huge role in the history of film and animation. The earliest animated character ever was a character named Gertie. Gertie the dinosaur, who was animated by a gentleman named Winsor McKay. He was a comic artist. He did Sunday broadsheet comics. And Winsor McKay came up with this idea of moving characters on screen. Well, you can trace something walking along like an elephant. It's called rotoscoping. But you can't trace a dinosaur. And so if he animated a dinosaur, he knew that he could convince the public that he had drawn it himself. So that was very exciting. That was the earliest animation ever. Barely 25 years later, the iconic Rite of Spring sequence in Disney's Fantasia was on screen. And that was an enormous amount of advancement in just 25 years. 50 years later, Jurassic Park, the first film that demonstrated that you must use computer digital effects. Well, let me tell you, it's been just as long between Gertie and Fantasia as it's been since Jurassic Park came out to today's Jurassic World film. So we like to think about this as the evolution of computer graphics on screen, which is very exciting. And you can now do with your phone the things that the artists couldn't have dreamed of for Jurassic Park. Well, in parallel to this, of course, paleontologists are not only watching the evolution of the technology that we use to bring dinosaurs to you on screen, we still continue to study the evolution of the organisms themselves. Dinosaurs go back as far as the late Triassic. They lived through the Jurassic and the Cretaceous, and everybody says the dinosaurs went extinct when the asteroid hit at the end of the Cretaceous. Well, the terrestrial dinosaurs did indeed. But dinosaurs are still with us today, because birds evolved from dinosaurs. So one of the great things that I get to talk about when I'm talking to students and interested people is that dinosaurs evolved from very primitive ones to more advanced ones and finally to birds. And we get to visualize these things for you with a technology that's been evolving as well. And one of the great things about the youth of today is that they're very technology savvy. And they understand what I mean when I say the technology is increasing in leaps and bounds. And then they're just as accepting as of the fact that change has taken place over time with the animals and plants and other things that lived at the time of the dinosaurs, because lots of other things were there too. The precursors of mammals, insects, bugs, plants, reptiles that swam in the ocean, reptiles that flew in the sky, all these things were around, and we study all of them, and then we bring them to you on screen, and everyone gets excited about it. All right, one of the things that we see in the history of animated dinosaurs is that Gertie, the earliest animated dinosaur, is this big lumbering creature. And that's even the case in the Fantasia dinosaurs. Of course, as we go farther along to the Jurassic Park and Jurassic World dinosaurs, they're much more active, they're much more agile, they're much faster in some cases. Okay. Well, that is because that's what we've learned over the past few years. Early on, we used to think that dinosaurs were too large to be agile creatures. Well, in fact, that turns out not to be the case. In the late 1960s, John Ostrom and one of his famous students, Bob Bakker, started to suggest that, you know, dinosaurs looked a lot like birds, and they were probably quite active and agile like birds. Now, they weren't suggesting that dinosaurs flew, but they were suggesting that they could move quickly, and like birds, they're probably quite intelligent. Okay? And so, over the years, our concept of dinosaurs has changed from these big, slow-moving, lumbering creatures to creatures that had bright displays, could move quickly, and in many cases were perhaps quite intelligent. So, similarly, the depiction of those dinosaurs on screen has also changed from the lumbering, slow, dim-witted dinosaur to something that is intelligent enough to hunt, okay, say, like what you saw in the original Jurassic Park film, or to plan as a group, as we see in birds, right? But now, of course, we use those same ideas in something like Jurassic World. Everybody thinks that Jurassic Park and Jurassic World are monster movies or fantasy movies. Well, they are in part, but much of the story that we put into those films is based on ideas that we get from biology, based on ideas that we get from science. And that's one of the reasons it's so exciting to me as a scientist. Well, one of the great things about being a paleontologist is we have to know about lots of different kinds of animals. So I teach a course in comparative animal anatomy, which means I need to know lots of lots of things about lots of different kinds of animals, including, say, reptiles and snakes and mammals and birds and all those kinds of things. So amongst mammals, for example, are mice and rats, little rodents. So one of the films I got to work on was Ratatouille. Now, you don't want the creatures in Ratatouille to look like, oh, a cartoony mouse. You don't want them to look like Mickey Mouse or Tom and Jerry or something like that. You want them to look like a unique character. And one of the things that the director of that film, Brad Bird, said is, I need these things to feel like a rat. Otherwise, the audience won't think there's a rat in the kitchen. They'll think Mickey Mouse is in the kitchen. So what we did is we made sure that the main character in that film and all of his cohort were shaped like rats. Even though later they stood up on their hind limbs, when they were on all fours, they moved like rats. And so when you see Remy in the kitchen, you go, oh, a rat in the kitchen. That's what we needed you to feel. I understand that he talks later. We know mice don't talk. We know rats don't talk. But because we introduced you to him as a rat, you continue to follow him as a rat in the film. And that's the strategy we use in all sorts of films where they're talking animals. We make sure you feel them as the animal so that you think of them as the animal throughout the story.